Okay, so good evening and welcome to our Learn and Share conference call. I'm Russ Derry, Director of Education for Epilepsy Foundation of Michigan, and I'll be moderating this discussion. The topic for tonight is deep brain stimulation for epilepsy, and we're pleased to have as our speaker Dr. Jason Schwalb, who is a neurosurgeon with the Henry Ford Comprehensive Epilepsy Program. Dr. Schwalb, could you briefly introduce yourself and talk a little bit about your clinical and research interests and describe your experience with this topic?
Sure. So I'm what's called a functional neurosurgeon at Henry Ford. I've been at Henry Ford about 10 years. And functional neurosurgery includes not just epilepsy surgery, but also surgery for pain and for movement disorders like Parkinson's disease, essential tremor, and dystonia. I have a fair amount of experience with the system that we're going to be talking about because I've been doing deep brain stimulation for tremor and Parkinson's disease for 20 years. So from that standpoint, it's really not very new. We're using a different target and treating a different condition, but the technology is actually fairly standard at this point.
Okay, great. So deep brain stimulation was FDA-approved for epilepsy just last year. So can you review the specifics of this approval?
Sure. So this was done, there was some basic science work in animals that eventually led to a study that was published in 2010 in the U.S. at about 6 or 7 centers around the United States. They did this protocol where patients were all implanted with DBS devices. And then half were turned on and half were left off for a certain period of time. And they looked at the seizure outcomes, you know, and tried to determine if active stimulation made a difference. In the initial publication, it actually did, or it seemed to. And when they submitted this was a trial that was run by Medtronic, which is the world's largest medical device manufacturer. And when they submitted the data to the FDA, the FDA noticed that they had thrown out one very unusual patient who was totally skewing their data. This is a patient who had a huge increase in number of seizures after the surgery for unclear reasons, probably not related to the surgery and potentially related just to variations in how often he or she had seizures. So the FDA said, you know, we're not buying it. You know, this isn't good enough for us to approve in the United States. But the sort of European equivalent of the FDA in the European Union did approve this device and this target then. So there's a fair amount of European experience. And actually, when I went through my training for this, at the recent American Epilepsy Society meeting in December, a lot of the speakers were Europeans, you know, who've had over 5 years' experience. So then the question is, well, how did it get approved now? So after that randomized time, you know, which was several months, where some patients were turned on, some patients were not turned on, everyone got turned on, and they followed those patients over time. They published the 5-year results in 2015. And essentially, this is not comparing these patients to a group that didn't get the surgery. It's just describing what happened to these patients and following them over time in a fairly meticulous manner, with patients taking diaries about their severity of seizures and frequency of seizures, and the results were actually fairly impressive. And it seems that at 5 years, you had patients where about 70% were getting greater than 50% reduction in their seizure frequency. And actually, there is a significant number of patients, you know, that had long stretches where they were actually seizure-free for several months. And these, of course, you know, these were patients that entered this trial and were sort of worse of the worst, otherwise they wouldn't have gone for this experimental treatment. But there are a fair number of patients that actually ended up having stretches of seizure freedom.
Okay, great. And for whom specifically is this FDA approved then?
So it's approved for patients, the labeling is for patients who have drug-resistant localization-related epilepsy. So drug-resistant in that they've failed, the patient has failed three appropriate medications for their condition and their type of seizures at appropriate dosing. So not homeopathic dosing, appropriate dosing. And localization-related, you know, this does not include patients with syndromes like Dravet syndrome or generalized epilepsy or juvenile myoclonic epilepsy or a lot of the other generalized epilepsies. That being said, just because it was self-delocalization related didn't mean that the investigators actually knew where the seizures were coming from. And I think that's one of the big differences about this is you don't have to necessarily pinpoint exactly where the seizures are coming from. If you look at the original paper that was published in 2010, the investigators thought that the vast majority were coming from the temporal or the frontal lobes. And I don't know that that was really skewed in terms of how they chose the patients. There were fewer patients with epilepsy arising from the parietal lobe or occipital lobe, but those are much rarer anyway. So looking at the patients in the trial, it's not like it was a huge number of patients. You know, they had 110 patients that were implanted, and they were able to get a five-year follow-up on 83, which is pretty good. Actually, probably a little bit more than 83, because some of the patients had dropped out or had other medical problems. You know, one died of liver cancer. So their follow-up was pretty good. But they still didn't have enough patients to really say, well, you know, the temporal lobe patients are the ones that are doing best, or it's the frontal ones or some other subgroup, you know, that are going to do the best with this technology. So we still don't really know, you know, which type of localization-related epilepsies are going to respond best. We have our guesses based on the anatomy of the target and what it's connected to. So this target, which is deep in the brain in an area of the brain called the thalamus, which is really a relay station at the center of the brain, is very much connected to the temporal and frontal lobes. So you would think that it might have a greater effect on patients who have seizures arising from their temporal or frontal lobes as opposed to their occipital or parietal lobes, but we don't really know yet whether it really makes a difference where the seizures are arising from.
Okay. Do you anticipate that there will eventually be off-label use or expanded FDA approval for generalized epilepsies or children or possible placement outside of the anterior nucleus of the thalamus?
Well, you know, I think looking at what's being done in Europe, you know, where they've had this technology for a few years, there have been some children that have been implanted. And I suspect that you'll probably see some children in this country who will end up implanted with localization-related epilepsy. And you know, I think in this country, the big issue is who's going to pay for it. So it's an expensive therapy. It's a fair amount of upkeep. It's the surgery. It's the equipment cost. It's the expertise of the hospital. So, you know, insurers are not going to pay for this unless they feel that there's good evidence supporting it. So it's not, you know, the reality is the way FDA labeling works. You can do things that are off-label. You know, we see lots of patients that have off-label use of medications, off-label use of even types of surgery, but that doesn't mean that anyone's going to pay for it unless the evidence is good. So will someone do generalized epilepsy? Maybe. If there's someone who will pay for it or if it's under a research protocol, is it something that Medtronic or another company is going to spend the money to run a large multi-million dollar trial to figure it out? I don't know. They have to figure out if they think it's going to be worthwhile. In terms of other targets, that I think, too, it's going to be a question of, you know, who's going to pay for it or is it under a research protocol. There is some work that's been done, actually starting in Mexico City with a fairly famous neurosurgeon and neurologist, the Velasco brothers, on a different targeting mesenchymal, but I don't know that that's really ready for prime time yet.
Okay. So can you describe the different components of the device, their placement, how they provide stimulation, and then the possible explanations for why this helps to reduce seizures?
Yeah. So there are really, in this system, there are three different components. There are the electrodes that go into the brain, and in general, the patient goes through surgery and has a hole that's about the size of a nickel drilled sort of in front behind their hairline that they have there, and the electrode goes through that burr hole into the brain. And then the electrodes that go into the brain are generally connected to an extension cord. It's usually placed at a separate surgery that runs behind the patient's ear, all underneath the skin, and then is connected to a pacemaker battery that's on the chest. So everything's underneath the skin. And usually the way this is set up is that the patient has a controller so that the patient can look at the controller and know if the device is on or off, because otherwise it's not like the patient feels anything when the device is running. So you can check that to make sure the device is on once a week or something like that, and also see how much battery life is left on the pacemaker. And then when the patient comes into the office, either the neurosurgeon or the neurologist has a more enabled programmer where he or she can manipulate how the current is delivered. How strong it is, how many pulses per minute, how wide those pulses are, you know, which contacts on the electrode the current is steered through for best benefit and minimize side effects. And so there's a fair amount of ability to do programming through the skin without having to open anything up.
Okay, and sounds like there's quite a wide range of setting options. How is there any kind of, presumably there's some research on what settings are the best place to start from and how much you can vary those settings in different directions to get desired results, right?
Yeah, exactly. The standard setting that were used in the initial trial, and the trial was called the SANTE, S-A-N-T-E trial. The initial settings were that the device is on for 1 minute and then off for five. And, you know, that's actually very different from other settings for DBS that we use for Parkinson's or tremor, but it's actually very similar to the settings we use for vagus nerve stimulation.
Right. Okay. And any ideas or as to the possible mechanisms for why it works?
It's not really clear. I mean, you know, I think we have some ideas based on our experience with DDS for other diseases like Parkinson's and essential tremor, in that it modulates the circuitry, it modulates how normal information travels through the circuits of the brain. The target where we place the electrode is sort of a switching hub where a very important circuit runs through called tape circuit, P-A-P-E. But we don't really know, you know, completely how it works. It's more an empiric finding developed in animals and then shown to be effective in humans.
Okay. So are there any unique advantages of DBS when compared with VNS and RNS? And are there specific types of epilepsy for which this treatment may be of particular benefit? And you kind of talked about that second half of that question a little bit already, but I guess what is the unique benefit as compared to VNS and RNS?
Well, so the issue with RNS so let's talk a little about RNS, which may be unfamiliar to people. So the idea of RNS is you figure out let me talk about sort of how we standardly approach a surgical epilepsy patient.
Sure.
So when you approach a patient with epilepsy, you know, when I'm approaching a patient with epilepsy and we're trying to figure out where the seizures are coming from my standpoint, you know, the best thing that I could find is that the seizures are coming from one place, and I can take that area of the brain out safely without hurting the patient, either causing a stroke or changing personality or changing their cognitive function. You know, that's what I hope for when we try and do a surgical evaluation, because, you know, those are patients that I have a fair likelihood of curing. Maybe they might not be off all their medications, but I can get rid of all their seizures that cause altered level of consciousness and keep them from driving and impair their memory and cause all sorts of other problems. And the success of those types of surgery, let's say, you know, is found to have temporal lobe epilepsy, you know, likelihood of making a patient seizure-free of disabling seizures is in the 60 to 80% range. All these other procedures like vagus nerve stimulation, RNS, DBS, they reduce the frequency of seizures. RNS and DBS, you can have, you know, good long periods of months or even a year or so where you can get the patient seizure-free, but you're much less likely to get the patient seizure-free. The seizure-free rate, you know, with RNS and DBS and VNS is in the 5 to 10% range, probably a little lower for VNS. So if we can do a resection, the reason we can do the resection is either the area of the brain the seizures are coming from is important, and I can't take it out without hurting the patient cognitively, or in terms of their movement or sensation or their vision, or the seizures are coming from multiple areas of the brain. And so taking one out, you know, isn't going to work, and taking two out probably isn't going to work either, because if there are two, there may very well be three or four. So we tend to be reluctant to take out multiple areas of the brain in different areas that aren't right next to each other. So in that case, RNS is an option. But to use RNS, you have to know exactly where the seizures are coming from. And then you can place an electrode either over that brain tissue or in that brain tissue, and then that's connected to a pacemaker that actually you put into the skull. You kind of cookie cutter a piece of the skull out and you put the pacemaker there. And this has a small computer that will detect when a seizure is starting and then deliver an electric pulse to abort the seizure before it spreads outside that area. So it's pretty similar to how a cardiac defibrillator works. You know, the defibrillator detects an abnormal heartbeat from an electrode that's in the heart, or an abnormal pattern of electrical spread, and then delivers a shock and stops that abnormal spread. And that can make a big difference. But you have to know where the seizure is coming from. And the way the current RNS device is right now is you really can only connect two electrodes to it. So if you've got seizures that are coming from three or four or five areas of the brain, it's not going to work. Now, the nice thing about VNS is you don't necessarily need to know where the seizures are coming from. And so you don't necessarily have to go through the whole process of trying to figure out where they're coming from. So I would say in general, we would do VNS first, vagus nerve stimulation first, because it's less invasive. And that too, you don't have to know exactly where the seizures are coming from. But if we think, you know, it's very likely to be multifocal, we're really not going to be able to figure out where the seizures are coming from, I think, you know, VNS is a good option, and then DBS is a good option. So I can tell you a little bit about our first patient that we're planning on implanting. It was a patient that we brought into the hospital. We tried to figure out where his seizures were coming from, and to do that, recording some scalp electrodes just didn't cut it, so we put in several electrodes into the brain or on the surface of the brain, and he sat in our epilepsy monitoring unit for 3 weeks and never had a seizure. So, I still don't know where his seizures are coming from. I have some ideas. I have a hypothesis, but it didn't really make sense to bring him in and try and reimplant him with intracranial electrodes to sit in our epilepsy monitoring unit for another 3 or 4 weeks and not have a seizure. So in him, we put in a vagus nerve stimulator, and that seemed to help a bit and reduce his seizures, but didn't help enough. And we're really trying to get patients seizure-free as much as possible. And so, you know, I can offer him DBS without having to put him through what's called phase two monitoring, where we put a bunch of electrodes either on or in the brain to figure out where the seizures are coming from. And that's sort of how I'm thinking about how we're going to implement this. I think if you look at the data look fairly similar for DBS and RNS. In terms of the outcome at 5 years, you know, with about 70% reduction in seizures, RNS is probably a little bit better. It's closer to 80, is what we're seeing. But, you know, so I think they're both in there. I think, you know, we're very comfortable with RNS because we've been doing it. We were part of the initial trial. So I think we tend to favor that. And I think it's also, you know, a workflow issue because, you know, we're still trying to figure out if we can cure a patient of epilepsy by taking out that area of the brain. So a lot of times we are doing intracranial recording, and so that it's very natural to transition to RNS if you have figured out where the seizures are coming from already, but you just can't take that area of the brain out safely.
Okay. So
does that make sense?
Yeah, essentially it sounds like for patients for whom the VNS seems to be the most appropriate option, but the VNS just isn't working as well as you would hope, then the DBS offers a different target, essentially, and for doing a very similar thing that may work better. Is
exactly.
That kind of it?
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, so when I talk to a patient about VNS, I tell them there's about 50% chance we'll get 50% reduction in their seizure frequency. You know, but the reality is that we really want to get patients seizure-free if we can. You know, we know that patients who are having, you know, even one seizure every 6 months is really disabling. You can't drive as many of the people, you know, who have epilepsy or have loved ones with epilepsy know. You know, you can't drive, but it's also that having uncontrolled epilepsy is dangerous. You know, if you have 3 grand mal seizures a year, you know, your risk of dying from your epilepsy over a decade is about 15%. It's really high. So, VNS can be helpful, but we're really trying to get patients as close to seizure-free as we can.
Right. So can you, you kind of gave a brief overview of the surgery, but can you describe the surgery itself in a little more detail, like what types of incisions are made, where, what anesthesia is used, how the
Sure.
placements of the depth electrode is guided, all that sort of thing?
Yeah, I mean, I think there are several ways to do this type of surgery. The traditional way of doing surgery in patients with tremor or Parkinson's disease is actually with the patient awake. We have a fair amount of experience in doing it with patients asleep under general anesthesia, and that's sort of how we're planning on doing these operations at Henry Ford. And from our standpoint, we will do it with either CT or MRI confirmation that the electrode is in the right place before we close the skin. In general, there are two incisions kind of behind the forehead, one on either side, and then usually we put the extension cords for both sides on the right and run it to pacemaker. So there's a small incision so we can tunnel the extension cords behind the ear. That's kind of about 2 inches above the top of the ear and maybe an inch behind that. And then there's an incision on the chest wall that's about 2 or 3 inches long.
Okay. And can you just describe the burr hole again, and is that a single hole or multiple?
Yeah, so it's generally one on each side, and it's about the size of a nickel. And when we put the electrodes in, there's actually a plastic housing, a medical grade plastic housing that holds the electrode in place. So it's not like there are divots on the patient's skull, or that you can, you know, if they're bald, you can't necessarily see, you're not going to see any divots or anything like that. We actually work pretty hard to try and make them cosmetically good, and so they're not actually proud and obvious.
Okay. What's the typical recovery time in the hospital and beyond? Is there anything that needs to be done after they're sent home?
Yeah, so most patients go home the day after surgery, and that's true of our, you know, older Parkinson's patients. So I expect the same, you know, from our fairly younger epilepsy patients. We tend to be fairly cautious and watch them in the ICU overnight to make sure there's no bleeding and to make sure their blood pressure is good control so that there's no bleeding. But then they go home the next morning. Weave in the battery and the extension cords as a separate procedure generally 2 weeks later. And then actually we usually wait a little bit before we turn the system on and do the programming in the office. So that's usually 4 weeks after the initial surgery. So the first surgery we're putting in the electrodes is, you know, anywhere between 2 and 5 hours. And that's an inpatient surgery with an overnight stay. The second surgery, we're running the extension cords and placing the battery. It takes about an hour, and that's an outpatient procedure. And then programming in the office takes a couple hours the first time, and then we're sort of tweaking that, you know, every month, you know, 2 to 4 weeks until we kind of think that we've found the right settings. And some of that is going to depend on the seizure frequency as well as to how often we have the patient come in for programming. In general, I would say, you know, patients will probably be, if they're working, will probably be off work about a month.
Okay.
But, you know, in terms of follow-up, this is a long-term commitment. You know, you're coming in, having the system checked, making sure everything's working. You know, generally I would think at least a couple times a year or once a year, something like that. And then the battery, the pacemaker battery, usually, at least in the study, seems to need to be changed about every 3 years. And that's about a 15-minute outpatient procedure.
Okay, great. So what are the primary risks associated with the surgery?
So at least in the trial, there were no deaths or serious strokes or increased pressure in the head. So I would expect that to be low. You know, our Parkinson's patients, you know, who are usually a fair amount older, they're usually in their 50s, 60s, and 70s, the likelihood of having bleeding in the brain is less than 1% per side. So I usually tell patients, you know, there's a 99% chance that you're not going to have a stroke related. I would expect that rate to probably be lower with this procedure just because there tends to be a younger, healthier population. The likelihood of having an infection in the brain is also exceedingly low. But there is a complication rate, and they tend to be hardware-related. You can get infections at the battery site. That is more bothersome than life-threatening, but it often, you know, can require having everything taken out because antibiotics really don't get to hardware through the bloodstream. So, and that happens about 5 to 10% of the time where they're having problems with the hardware or wire breaks or something like that. So most of the complications in the trial in the 110 patients were hardware related. There wasn't any clear cognitive complications, and that's actually sort of an odd story. One would think that since this is part of the memory circuitry that it might have some effects on memory. And about 20 to 30% of patients at some point along the first 5 years complained that their memory wasn't so good or that they were a little more depressed. But when you did formal neuropsychological testing, because they were having fewer seizures, they actually performed better on their memory and on their cognitive function in general, as we see when we do resective surgery or any procedure, because the high doses of the medications that they're on and the uncontrolled seizures, you know, the terrible things to people's cognitive function and memory. So it's a little unclear what's going on, that patients are having subjective complaints, but objectively they're actually doing better. Is that because they're doing better and they have a better idea of what's going on and notice that they have deficits that they didn't notice before because they were so disabled by their seizures? I don't know. Is it because the tests that we're doing aren't sensitive enough? That's a possibility too. But that has been reported, and that's something that I plan on sort of warning all the patients about. And hopefully this is something that, you know, if the patient complains about it, we can adjust the settings on the device to try and reduce that.
Okay. So you mentioned the possible effects on cognition and mood. Are there other side effects associated with deep brain stimulation?
It depends. I mean, I think, you know, really in the trial, there really wasn't. So, you know, looking at the results at 5 years, you know, sometimes patients felt tingling or vibration generally at the pacemaker site or had discomfort at the pacemaker site. That's sort of the most likely thing. Some patients felt abnormal sensations, about 8%. And about 6% complained of dizziness. So some of these are based on the electrode not necessarily being in the right place, and that's why we're so careful before we even close the skin to make sure it is. But even when it is, when you're in the operating room, it can move, even though we kind of screw it into place to make sure or try and reduce those risks. But most of them are things that you can fix, either by fixing the system or moving the electrode if it's not in the right place.
Okay. Are the wires from the leads or from the leads to the pulse generator actually visible through the skin, or is it barely noticeable?
So it depends on the, in our experience with our Parkinson's and tremor patients, it depends on how thin they are. You know, patients who are quite thin, you'll see sometimes the wire underneath the skin kind of in the neck and coming over the collarbone. It's usually not particularly obvious unless you know what you're looking for. It's not like people are staring at you on the street, like what's going on. If you go to the beach, it's pretty clear that you've got a pacemaker. So that's not any different than any other pacemaker. You can usually see some degree of the outline under the skin if the person is thin. What we've tended to do for our thin tremor patients, especially the women who want to be able to wear sweeping necklines, is we'll actually use longer extension cords and put the battery in the belly. And then they can wear one piece or, low-cut top, and you're really not going to see it.
Oh, okay. Is there any responsive or on-demand stimulation feature with the DBS, or is that a possibility on the horizon?
So there isn't yet, and that's a very different system than the NeuroPace RNS system. They are developing, Medtronic is developing responsive neurostimulation, what they call a brain radio, that they've been doing some research in about the past 5 years for tremor and for Parkinson's disease. So one would assume or one would think, once they feel that they've got a market for that they might bring that along into the epilepsy field. But I am not aware of any current plans of them doing that.
Okay. So can you, you've kind of mentioned some of this already, but just can you do a quick summary of what the research has shown in terms of seizure-related outcomes for DBS in epilepsy?
Sure. So, if you look at the five-year results, the patients actually do quite well. So about 70% have a more than 50% reduction in their seizure frequency. And about 16% were seizure-free for at least 6 months. And not just in terms of their seizure frequency, there are also improvements in their severity of their seizures. So there's something called the Liverpool seizure severity scale that the patients had significant improvements in. And then there's a kind of overall gestalt looking at quality of life in epilepsy. That's a scale called the quality 36, I think they used for this paper, that also showed significant improvement. So it's really, kind of across all domains. And when they looked at the neuropsychological outcomes, there was significant improvement in attention, in executive function, which is kind of multitasking, puzzle solving, and also in the patient's subjective cognitive function. So in spite of that, 30% that felt they were worse, the vast majority actually felt that their thinking was much clearer.
Okay. Are there any restrictions or precautions related to having a DBS implanted, like things related to MRI use or anything like that?
Absolutely. So the systems are what's called MRI conditional. So they are generally safe for MRI as long as you turn it off prior to the MRI. But really, you need to make sure before you put a patient in the MRI that there are no short circuits or open circuits. So in general, we need someone to be able to check the system to make sure that there are no short circuits or open circuits and that everything's in working order before they have their MRI. Sometimes the scanning parameters are such that you have to modify the way you do the MRI for a patient who has a DBS system in place. And sometimes it can make the scan take longer. So it's really only should be done at a center that's used to be doing MRIs, you know, on patients with DBS. This is not, if you have a DBS system, you shouldn't be going out to some, you know, strip mall MRI place, you know, to get your MRI. You really need to go someplace that has a physicist, you know, which most of the teaching hospitals and big hospitals in the area do. Has a physicist, has someone that knows what they're doing and can coordinate the patient coming in with someone to interrogate the system, make sure it's working. The upside to that is, you know, you're not getting called in for an MRI at 2 in the morning. They tend to do that during business hours, so that's a plus. The other big caveat for DBS is something is ultrasound or I'm blanking on the term. It's something that's used by the dentists that's sort of ultrasound-like, that's sometimes used through clean gums.
Oh, yeah.
And that can actually cause it's called diathermy. That's what it's called.
Oh,
and that can actually cause the electrode to heat up and actually burn the tissue. So, you know, there was one patient with Parkinson's disease 15 years ago that had diathermy and actually had a hemorrhage in their brain and died. And so we don't want a second. But those are really the only major restrictions. Patients with DBS systems who are undergoing surgery generally need to have a conversation with the surgeon, because there are certain settings for cautery that should be avoided. Otherwise, there's a risk of damaging the battery. But that's not life-threatening. That means, you know, you might, if you get your knee replaced and they use both the electrocautery, they might damage the battery and you might have to have it replaced sooner than you were otherwise planning. I don't know of any reports of that causing anything life-threatening.
Okay. So other than the battery, do any of the other components of the system ever need to be replaced or repositioned? You mentioned possibly having to reposition the leads, but anything else have a finite?
Usually not. I've seen weird things. I've had patients, you know, with Parkinson's fall on the connector between the DBS electrode and the extension and damage it that way. But you know, with there shouldn't be any like normal wear and tear or planned obsolescence that you would need to replace.
Okay.
Anything really other than the battery, unless, you know, something happens.
And can DBS be used if someone already has an RNS or VNS, and kind of vice versa? Can someone with DBS then go on to get an RNS or VNS or even resective surgery in the future?
So in terms of VNS, actually a fair number of the patients in the initial trial had had either VNS or had had resective surgery and failed resective surgery. So that's not a problem. That we know is safe. In terms of going between DBS and RNS, I think we don't know. I think the main issue would be with RNS, if the RNS, whoever the neurologist who would be programming the RNS would have to be pretty careful to make sure it's not picking up the stimulation from the DBS and interpreting that as a seizure and delivering an electric pulse.
Yeah.
So we don't know, you know, but there could be some programming issues. But, you know, the reality is that if the patient's failing RNS and you want to put in a DBS, you probably turn the RNS off, you know, or vice versa. So I don't see anything that would really preclude, one versus the other. Preclude having one if you already have the other, but you might want to turn one of the systems off or be very careful about the programming. There's nothing to preclude having resective epilepsy surgery after DBS. But the reality is that, you know, most of the patients coming through will have been evaluated for whether they're candidates for resective surgery before going on to DBS. But, you know, you're right. If some new technology comes out that we're able to much better identify seizure onset zone, and we know exactly where the seizures are coming from and it's resectable, I'd definitely be in favor of that if the patient wasn't getting adequate relief from the DBS.
Mm-hmm. What other, you mentioned this, the brain radio, what are some other neuromodulation techniques or devices that might be in the pipeline or on the horizon that you've heard about that people might be interested in learning more about? I know there's the whole trigeminal nerve stimulation, which I'm not sure where that's gone. So can you kind of talk just about what else is out there in neuromodulation that may be on the horizon?
Well, I think these are sort of the, I don't know much about trigeminal nerve stimulation. I mean, I think these are sort of the main things that are coming along. There's hope for more specific neuromodulation via something called optogenetics. A lot of that work has been developed at Stanford. Whether that will actually make it to commercial use is not clear to me. There is a lot of interest in gene therapy for epilepsy, and not just focal epilepsy, but for some of the generalized epilepsies. Those are sort of the things that I'm seeing, when I'm going to meetings and talking to other consultants.
Okay. All right. So before we open it up for questions, do you have any closing thoughts for our listeners?
I do. I mean, I think this is a great option, and it really adds to our armamentarium. For us, we're very concerned about patients who have uncontrolled epilepsy, and I think sometimes people kind of get used to what they're used to, even when it's not great, and are afraid of surgery. But I would encourage people, if you're having more than two seizures with altered level of consciousness a year, and you failed to medications, to have a surgical evaluation, because the reality is that the risks of surgery are generally much less than the risks of continued ineffective medical therapy.
Okay. All right, so we'll go ahead and open it up for questions. Okay, who'd like to get us started with a question?
Okay, my husband is a 54-year-old man. Not very healthy. He's had six pneumothoraxes, a broken collarbone. He has irrefractable epilepsy that is radiating around to his memory sensory. He has uncontrolled epilepsy for the last 20 years. And he has all different kinds of seizures. I've seen him have up to 18 grand mals a day. And we're in the process of looking into brain surgery, and he is having memory loss.
Yeah, so that's not uncommon with people with bad epilepsy, either because of their uncontrolled seizures or side effects from the various seizure medications that are being tried. Seizure medications act by damping down how the electrical signals are going through the brain, but that's not just epilepsy, that's also normal function. So what I would say is that at least we try really hard not to hurt anyone. Our goal is to, and the reality is that in appropriately chosen patients, their cognitive function generally gets better when they're no longer having seizures all the time and when they're able to come down on their meds. So we're very concerned about those sort of neuropsychological issues, and for anyone who hasn't gone through neuropsychological testing, it's about 3 to 5 hours of puzzles and other testing to really figure out how the different areas of the brain are working, and if it's safe to take out the part of the brain that's involved with the seizure generation, if we can figure out where the seizures are coming from. So, I have to tell you, when I was a resident, I remember having a patient come in that sounds a little bit like your husband, you know, who had, you know, long, long years, actually a little bit older. She had like 30 years of temporal lobe epilepsy, and mm-hmm. she had really burned out her temporal lobes. And you know, at that point, her memory, when we did neuropsychological testing, was terrible. And you know, had we gone out, and it was really too late to get her memory back. So she just burned out the parts of her brain. So we mm-hmm. could have taken her out and maybe made a difference in her seizures, but it wouldn't have made much of a difference in her memory because it was too late. So, I would encourage you, you know, as I said, the risks of poorly controlled epilepsy are much higher than the risks of epilepsy. And that's not just in terms of life and mortality. That's also in terms of cognitive function. So if he's worried about cognitive decline, you know, continued epilepsy is probably higher risk for that than surgery.
Right. Well, we went for our first EMU stay in Grand Rapids. We've been to EMU stays at U of M, but they didn't offer any solutions. All they did was, you know, pacify us, give us more medication. That's all doctors have been doing for the last 20 years is just giving us more medication, yeah. different medication, try this, try that. And nobody's given us any hope. And every time they give us new medication, he seems to get worse and worse and worse. You know,
yeah.
So the medication is definitely not working. And
does he have VNS at least?
Does he have what? Vagus
nerve
stimulator? No.
Yeah.
Dr. Burnett said that wouldn't even work on him. I've also tried CBD oils, which do not work on him either.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I think obviously they're excellent people across the state at a number of different centers. You know, I think, and Dr. Burnett is an excellent epileptologist who you see at Henry Ford. I worked with him. And if at some point, you know, you want another opinion, feel free to come to the east side of the state too.
Oh, I totally love Dr. Burnett because he does care about his patients, and he's the first epileptic specialist in the last 20 years that I found that cares, you know what I mean, enough to say, hey, you need this done, and this is what needs to be
yeah.
done. Now, he also has cyclic vomiting syndrome, which is known as abdominal epilepsy, abdominal seizures. Sometimes that'll just trigger an episode.
Right.
So I don't even know.
I definitely think, you know, just simply due to the frequency of his seizures and the fact that medications clearly have not taken care of it, you're doing definitely the right thing, fully exploring all surgical options. So, all right, do we have other questions?
This is Marissa.
Yeah.
I got a question. Can age be a factor in having the procedure done, the DBS? Say, like if you're 50 and older or 60 and older.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. We don't think so. I mean, looking at the trial that was done and most of the experience from Europe, these are younger patients. But, you know, we operate on patients in their 80s for tremor without a problem. So I have no objections, you know, to operating on elderly patients with this. In the initial trial, it was restricted to 18 to 65, but that's not the way the FDA labeling is. The FDA labeling basically said that they didn't approve it for children. Whether insurers will pay for it for children is another matter, but it's not FDA approved for anyone under 18.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Great. Other questions?
Yes, I have a question.
Great.
So my name is Emily, and I'm new to looking for resources at all. But I've had a mass on my left posterior thalamus that was actually discovered more than 10 years ago. And they, for a long time, were assuming that it was most likely a low-grade glioma, but then I surpassed the number of years it would normally start to be active, I guess. So recently, a panel of U of M radiologists looked at it, and they said that because I've surpassed those years for low-grade glioma, they think it's likely a focal cortical dysplasia, or and that is likely what causes my seizures. But I now that I am learning to identify seizures, I'm able to recognize that I have multiple kinds of them, and that I have them routinely. I've just for more than 10 years, you know, developed my own workarounds or attributed it to other things, and different neurologists have been calling, thinking they might be this or might be that for a long time. You know, was this a TIA? Was this a seizure? Was this? Well, now I have EEGs that consistently come up abnormal. My last one didn't show epileptical activity. The one before that did. The last one I couldn't fall asleep for it. But then I ended up having a full body seizure like a month later, when I normally have blackout seizures or focal seizures that cause language and confusion issues, as well as loss of feeling on one side of my body. But I've now had so many different kinds of seizures, and of course, they can't operate on it. So I'm not sure. I'm just starting the process of what do I do now that I know I can't drive. I mean, if I had known these were seizures for a long time, I probably would have several times not been driving. But I'm not sure what my options are not being able to operate. And I've tried Topamax. I'm trying Keppra, and they just increased it after my last seizure. But I also know that if it's caused by that mass, that it's unlikely to respond to medicine. So I wonder if some of the things that you're talking about might be more, might be effective, even if medicine is not.
Yeah, I think they would be. You know, what I would say is, you know, we would generally not initiate a surgical workup, and it's not clear, you know, without reviewing your records in detail to determine if you're a surgical candidate for resection or not, or for laser ablation. We have seen, you know, many patients that get told at other centers that they're not candidates for surgery, and then they do great with surgery. So we tend to be pretty aggressive in trying to figure out if it's resectable and if we can do it. That being said, you know, if it is not resectable and you failed to adequate trials of medication, you know, the likelihood of a third or a fourth or a fifth medication making a difference and giving you seizure freedom is only about 4%. And that hasn't changed in 20 years with the addition of multiple new seizure medications. So I would encourage you, you know, to get another opinion and see if someone else might think this might be resectable if you fail the medications. And if not, consider vagus nerve stimulation, and if that doesn't work, then DBS. I think it would be a very reasonable candidate for that.
Okay, and because you wouldn't consider, would you not consider the thalamus something that you absolutely don't touch? Because I know the risks are pretty high, but I've been under the impression for 10 years now that we don't go near to touching.
Yeah,
we
do. A lot of people don't, but, you know, we have a fair amount of experience at Henry Ford with tumors in the thalamus, less so with focal cortical dysplasias. But, you know, if we did intracranial monitoring that showed that that was it and that was the only place that your seizures are coming from, I would feel comfortable doing a laser ablation of it, depending on what it looks like on the MR.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and Dr. Schwalb, can you just briefly review what laser ablation involves and when that might
be? Sure, absolutely. Yeah, so this is a new technique. We've been doing it, about 5 years. And people had taught, one of the issues, especially with temporal lobe epilepsy, is that you have to go through a lot of somewhat normal brain to get to the hippocampus, which is usually where the seizures are coming from. And so people work pretty hard to do more selective open surgical techniques to take out the hippocampus and amygdala, which is usually the culprit, without damaging the adjacent brain. And then people had tried putting in a probe and burning the hippocampus, but that's a little dicey. There's some important stuff nearby. And then what really changed actually was the MRI technology. So we now have sequences in MRI where you can monitor the temperature of the brain in real time. So we are actually doing this as part of a trial now, although we also do cases outside the trial. We do this both for brain tumors and for epilepsy, where we put a fiber optic laser probe that is surrounded by a cooling catheter that you circulate water through to keep the tissue from heating up. And then we have the patient in the MRI when we're heating up the laser probe to burn the tissue. And this allows you to get sort of much deeper areas of the brain where you couldn't get to before because you'd be going through too much normal tissue. So we are currently involved in a trial called the SLATE trial, which is sponsored by Medtronic for laser ablation for temporal lobe epilepsy. We had actually done 5 patients prior to the trial and had had very good success with that. Now we're doing it as part of the trial. But we can do patients outside of the trial if their seizures are not coming from the mesial temporal lobe. For something like a focal coracoid dysplasia. And there is a growing literature on doing laser ablation for focal coracoid dysplasias and for other focal epilepsies like tuberous sclerosis-related epilepsy as well. So it's pretty new, past 5 years, but it can be actually quite effective.
And presumably it's a good option for people whose seizure focus is in an area that is difficult to reach through standard resective surgery.
Yeah, it's deep. And the amazing thing about it is that, when you look at the scans, and I've looked at scans on our patients 6 months, 12 months later, the area that you ablated, that you lasered is gone. And the surrounding tissue looks normal. I mean, it really is very, very focal without a lot of damage to things you don't want to damage. I mean, really, with the MR monitoring, with the cooling catheter, with just sort of the way this technology works as opposed to just heating up an electric probe, you really get a very sharp demarcation, and this is clear when you look at pathology too, when this was done in animals and things like that. You see a very sharp demarcation between the area that's been damaged and ablated and the adjacent normal brain. The adjacent normal brain looks pretty normal.
Great. All right. Any other questions on DBS?
Neuromodulation, I had one.
Surgery. Go ahead.
Yeah. Can you explain the differences again between DBS and RNS relative to the electrodes and the number or their
frequency? Sure. Yeah. So there's RNS. You can use either one or two electrodes, but you have to know where the seizures are coming from. You have to put the electrodes exactly in that area for it to work. And usually it's a fair amount of work to figure out where the seizures are coming from. And if it's more than two areas, it doesn't work. And then with DBS, it is two electrodes, one on either side. But you don't need to know where the seizures are coming from. And presumably it's going to work if there are 2, 3, 4, or 8 areas where seizures are coming from.
Okay, that's interesting. Thank you.
All right. Other questions related to DBS, neuromodulation, or surgery in general?
No, I'm good.
All right. So I think we will go ahead and wrap it up. So for future reference, if anyone is...
Hello?
Yep, go ahead. Did you have a question?
Hi. Yeah. So with DBS, how does the power work again? Like, you implant it into the chest, or like, how's it charged? Or sorry, I kind of like forgot how that all went.
Yeah, no worries. No, it's a primary cell. It's not a rechargeable battery. It's more like a Duracell than your iPhone. And so the batteries, they're pretty sturdy and they have pretty good battery life. They generally need to be changed every 3 years. So the battery is in the chest underneath the skin. And then it's connected through a couple of extension cords to the battery, to the wires that are going into the brain.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Great. Okay, any other questions? All right, so we will go ahead and wrap it up. So I do want to encourage people, if you have any additional questions about any of these treatment options, please feel free to call us at 1-800-377-6226 or visit our website at epilepsymichigan.org. And just to let you know, our next Learn and Share conference call will be on March 6th from noon to 1:30. The topic is Disability Laws, Your Rights in Education, Employment, and Beyond. And that's featuring Mark McWilliams, who's an attorney with Michigan Protection and Advocacy Service. So if you're interested in that and have not yet registered, please let me know, or you can register online. And Dr. Schwalb, thank you so much for your time and your expertise in sharing what you know about deep brain stimulation. This is exciting, and we're interested in learning more in the future.
My pleasure. Thank you for the opportunity.
Yeah. All right. Thanks, everyone, for joining us tonight.
Thank you, guys. Have a nice night.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
Okay.